Okay, so this is a continuation of the previous lecture. See, what we saw in the previous lecture was that if you have an analytic continuation along an arc or a path, then which is given by a family of power series also parameterized by the path variable, okay, then the coefficients an as well as the radius of convergence are continuous functions of the path parameter, okay. Now what I am going to do now is going to tell that because of this I am going to tell that the whole analytic continuation, all the functions FTs for t greater than a, they are all completely determined by FA, namely the initial function. So in other words, I am saying if you have a path for which you have fixed a parameterization, and if you have an analytic continuation of a function along this path, then the analytic function at the starting point of the path determines all the other analytic functions that correspond to power series later on in the path. Okay, it's a what it says is, if you give me a particular parameterization of a path and if you start with an analytic function at the initial point, then all the analytic functions that you will get at various points by analytic continuation, they are all uniquely determined, okay. In other words, for the same parameterization of a path, you cannot find two different analytic continuations for which the power series at t are different with the initial power series being the same, okay. So let me write that down. So here is a theorem, given an analytic continuation FT of z equal to sigma n equal to 0 to infinity an of t z minus gamma of t to the power of n mod z minus, so this power series is valid in this disk of convergence which is mod z minus gamma of t centered at gamma t radius r t along a path comma so the statement is FT for t greater than a is uniquely determined by FA. So the starting, so the power series at t equal to a, namely the initial point of the path, the value of the parameter t when it is equal to a, it is the initial value of the parameter, and the corresponding power series FA is the initial power series you are starting with, and I am saying that that initial power series, that analytic function that determines all the other analytic functions that you are going to get in terms of power series along as you continue analytically along that path. Okay. So in other words, I am saying if you give me a path with a fixed parameterization, and if I start with an analytic function at the initial point, okay, if I do any indirect analytic continuation along that path, okay, then at the end of the path I am going to get one and the same analytic function. Not only at the end, in fact I am going to get, given any other point on the path, the analytic continuation of that function I am going to get at that point is going to be unique. Okay. So the analytic continuation is completely controlled by the initial function and the path. That's what I am trying to say. Okay. So what is the proof? The proof essentially, actually, you know, if you think about it, it's just tautological to this lemma that an and r of t are continuous functions of t. Okay. But let me explain that. So it's a proof by contradiction. All right. So suppose the theorem were false. Then it means that you start with FA fixed. You could have there could be a certain t for which you could get different. Families of power series, okay, which both start with the same FA, the same function FA, but at later on at some point for some value t of the parameter greater than A, the corresponding power series are different analytic functions, okay, if that is what it means to contradict this theorem, okay. So let me write that. Then there exists Gt of z is equal to sigma n equal to 0 to infinity bn of t z minus gamma of t to the power of n mod z minus gamma of t is less than, so you know I will use r tilde of t, because r tilde of t will be the radius of convergence of gt of z of the power series gt of z centered at gamma of t. Okay, so I am using a different r, okay, and such that which is also an analytic continuation along gamma starting with GA equal to FA and with GT not equal to FT for some t greater than A. So the claim is that you give me one analytic continuation like this along the path, then that's the only thing you can get. So long as you have fixed the initial function FA, okay. And how do I oppose this claim? I oppose this claim by saying that there is another analytic continuation, okay, with the property that it also begins at A with the same function. So GA is FA. So this power series at t equal to A starting point is the same as this power series, as functions they are the same, okay, at the starting point, but for a certain value of t greater than A, the corresponding functions I am getting are different, okay. That's how I am contradicting the statement of the theorem, and now I have to get a contradiction. Now the contradiction is very evident, because the contradiction will just come in a very easy way. Let t naught be the infimum of t in AB such that FT is not f, ft is not equal to gt, okay. So there is one t beyond A for which ft and gt are different functions, okay. So you can look at the smallest such t, you can take the infimum, you can look at the least such t, then of course you know fa is equal to ga, therefore this t naught is greater than A. Clearly t naught is greater than A, no doubt about it. T naught cannot be A because fa is equal to ga, right. And you see when I take infimum of all these t's, okay, you know the infimum is also, it has also a limiting property. The infimum of a set of real numbers which is bounded below is a limit of those set of a suitable sequence in that set, okay. So there is a, whenever you study infimum and supremum in a first course in analysis, you always have the so called approximation property of the infimum or supremum, which says that the infimum or supremum is actually a limit, okay. So it is a limiting property. So this infimum is a certain limit of all t's with a certain property, and it exists because all these numbers, all these t's are bounded. So this is, you know, if you recall a first course in analysis, real analysis, you would have come across this statement that you know that every subset of real numbers which is bounded below has an infimum is equivalent to saying that every subset of real numbers which is bounded above has a supremum, and that's equivalent to the completeness of the real line, okay. It's a very deep statement. So it's also equivalent to the monotone convergence theorem, that any sequence of real numbers that's decreasing and bounded below converges, or equivalently any sequence of real numbers that is increasing and bounded above also converges, okay. All these statements are equivalent to the completeness of the real line, which is a deep fact, okay. So the infimum exists because this, all these t's are bounded below by A, okay. And the infimum has a, the infimum, if you call it as t naught, it has a limiting property. So it is a limit of a sequence, and since the closed interval AB is closed, the infimum also belongs to that interval, okay. And and the infimum cannot be A, it has to be greater than A, right. Now I will get easily a contradiction for any t close to t naught and lesser than t naught. If you compare, see, because I have to use the fact that you know ft is an analytic continuation, therefore you know for t prime, for every t, for t prime sufficiently close to t, ft prime has to be equal to ft. Similarly for all t prime close to t, gt prime also has to be equal to gt. So what you will get is for all t prime very close to t naught and lesser than t naught, okay, you will get ft prime is equal to gt, and ft prime is also so you will get ft prime, so ft prime is equal to ft naught, and you will also get ft prime is equal to gt naught, and it will contradict the fact that ft naught is not equal to gt naught, okay. So so let me write that down. We have ft prime is the same as ft naught minus epsilon, okay, and you will have and that will be equal to f, that will be equal to g t naught minus epsilon, which is g equal to gt prime, okay. You will have this, see, you will have this because ft is an analytic continuation. So for t prime close to t naught minus epsilon, ft prime has to be equal to ft naught minus epsilon, and but ft naught minus epsilon has to be equal to gt naught minus epsilon because t naught is the smallest of those values for which ft is not equal to gt. So anything lesser, so the infimum is called the is the greatest lower bound. Anything less than that is not a lower bound, okay. So t naught minus epsilon is lesser than the infimum, so it's not going to be a low, I mean so this condition is not going to be true for t naught minus epsilon. So which means that f t naught minus epsilon should be the same as g t naught minus epsilon, right? Because this t naught is the least, your, if you go to the left of t naught, the ft's and gt's will be the same, right? So these two are equal because of definition of t naught, and these two are equal because gt is an analytic integration, okay? But also ft naught minus epsilon is the same as ft naught, and gt naught minus epsilon is also equal to gt naught for epsilon small enough. This is also true, okay? All right, probably this is the maybe even the previous statement is not important, maybe it's, this is the statement that is important. See, if you choose epsilon small enough, then ft naught minus epsilon should be the same as ft naught, and gt naught minus epsilon should be equal to gt naught, okay? All right, and so you will get, this will tell you that ft naught is the same as gt naught, okay? And you see, the same argument will also apply instead of minus epsilon, if I put plus epsilon also it works. See, because here I can put, instead of minus I can put plus or minus, okay? Here also I can put plus or minus. That's because ft is an analytic continuation. If you take t naught and you take a small neighborhood around t naught, okay, then all the ft primes should be the same as ft naught, okay? And similarly, since gt is an analytic continuation, if you take gt naught and you take a small neighborhood surrounding t naught, all the gt primes should be equal to gt naught, okay? And so what this will tell you is, for epsilon small enough, so I can put plus or minus, and then you will, of course, if you take it with the plus you get a contradiction. If you compare these two, all right, and if you compare these two, all right, what you will get is that ft naught plus epsilon and gt naught plus epsilon will be the same for epsilon small enough. So this implies ft naught plus epsilon is equal to gt naught plus epsilon for epsilon small enough. A contradiction to the definition of t naught. See, I am just looking at a neighborhood of t naught. Okay, if I look at values before t naught, then all the ft primes and the gt primes are the same. All right, and they should also represent the same function to the right of t naught also, okay? But then to the right of t naught, ft naught and gt, the ft's and gt's are supposed to be there are supposed to be points to the right of t naught as close to t naught as I want, where ft and gt are different because of the approximation property of the infimum, and that's a contradiction, okay? So let me repeat this. If you look at the point, if you look at the point t naught, at the point t naught, if you took at the power series ft naught, that ft naught has to be equal to the power series ft naught minus plus or minus epsilon for epsilon sufficiently small, and it, and gt naught also similarly has to be equal to g sub t naught plus or minus epsilon for epsilon sufficiently small. But if you take minus, if you look at t naught minus epsilon, okay, then the ft's and the gt's are the same because of the definition of t naught. So what this will tell you is that ft's and gt's are also the same for values greater than t naught, which is not for all values in a neighborhood to the right of t naught. But that's not supposed to be, because given however small a neighborhood to the right of t naught, there is a value t for which ft is not equal to gt, that is the approximation property of the infimum, okay? So this contradiction it's a subtle contradiction, uses some very basic analysis. So this contradiction tells you that your theorem is true, okay. So this is, that's the end of the proof. So the moral of the story is the following. The moral of the story is, you know, if you give me a parametric path, if you give me a path and you have parameterized it, and you start with a function at the starting point of the path, then that, then any analytic continuation along the path, if it exists, then it is uniquely determined, okay. So in particular, so everything depends on the parameterization of the path and this initial function, okay, everything depends on that. Fine. So anyway, the moral of the story is that if you give me a parametric path and if you give me an initial function, then then there is only one analytic continuation which starts with that function. There cannot be more than one, okay. But of course, it may happen that there is no analytic continuation at all. There may be a path along which you cannot continue a function analytically. That could happen. So what I want to do next is, I want to tell you about two things. First of all, you could have a path on which along which you cannot have an analytic continuation at all, okay. And that will happen, for example, even with a function which has a non-removable singularity at a point, okay. So you know, for example, so let me make this definition. We say f analytic function f at z naught is analytically continuable along a path gamma starting at z naught if there exists an analytic continuation ft, t belonging to AB, where gamma is the path from AB, gamma is a path parameterized with a parameter variable in this interval such that f a is f, and of course gamma of a is z naught. So I am saying that if you have a point z naught and you have a path starting from z naught and you have a function which is analytic in a neighborhood of z naught, if you, we say that it is analytically continuable along the path if you can find an analytic continuation given by a family of power series parameterized by the path, parameterized by the interval which also parameterizes the path, such that the beginning function is your given function, okay. So the fact is, so the question is, so our aim is, you start with an analytic function at a point, try to look at all possible paths along which you can continue it and try to find out what is the analytic function you are going to get at the end of the path, okay. So that is the aim, and the philosophy is that if you do this, then you will get all possible branches of that analytic function, okay. So this this analytic continuation will give you all possible branches of a given analytic function, right. So so there can be analytic functions which cannot be continued along a path. So for example, you know, so here is an example, if f is analytic on a domain D, then of course f is analytically continuable along any path in D, then f is analytically continuable along any path in D gamma in D. It's very simple, right, because you see, so you know, if you have some D here in the complex plane, it's a domain, and you know, if you have a path, if you have a path like this gamma, then you know, so f is defined here with values in C. Any analytic function within its domain of analyticity can be continued along any path in the domain of analyticity. It's very very simple. What you do is you just define at each point of the path, just define the power series to be the power series, just the Taylor series expansion of f at that point. That's all. Okay. So it's trivial that if a function is analytic in a domain, then it can be analytically continued along every path in that domain, and all these analytic continuations are not going to produce anything. They are going to give you back the function f. Okay, so so you know, if you have this situation, you just define f t of z is equal to power series that is Taylor series of f centered at gamma t. That's all. If you make this definition, then f t will give you, yeah, automatically it will give you a analytic continuation of f along that path. And what is that analytic continuation? It's a trivial analytic continuation. It is simply you are not going to get anything new. You are going to just get back the same function along the whole path. Okay, all the f t is, okay, all the f t is, the power series will be different, because the power series will change as the center of the power series changes. The power series will change, the coefficients will change, okay. But finally, what function do they converge to? They all converge to the same function f. So all the FTs are, as a function, they are the same f, okay. But only thing is, if you write them as power series, you get different power series, and the power, you get different power series because you have changed the centers, okay. So this is just the statement that if a function is analytic on a domain, then I mean, you have, it's trivially analytically continuable on any path on the domain, okay. Then the other important example is of a function which you cannot analytically continue, and that is the case when your path ends at a point which is a bad point for the function, which is a singular point for the function. So example, you know, if you take f of z is equal to 1 by z cannot be continued, analytically continued along any path passing through the origin. That's obvious, because the origin is a, you know, it's a simple pole. Okay, so you cannot analytically continue it along a path which crosses the origin, because at the origin you cannot find, after all, the function 1 by z is defined, its domain of analyticity is a punctured plane, it is a whole complex plane minus the origin. So only point where it is not defined is the origin, where at that point it has a simple pole. All right, now at that point you cannot extend it, okay. So so if you have any path passing through the origin, you cannot analytically continue it. So you know, this gives you a hint that, you know, somehow if you keep track of all possible paths along which your function can be analytically continued, then you will get points which are good points, reasonably good points for the function, okay. So this leads to a definition. So let me make a statement. So here is one more important example. The analytic function you know, log z, which is principal branch of the logarithm, which is given by log z is ln mod z plus I times principal argument of z, where principal argument of z is taken from minus pi to pi. this has maximal domain of analyticity. The slit plane, namely complex plane minus you remove the line segment from minus infinity to 0, okay. So it is a slit plane, you just throw out this 0, the origin and the negative real axis, on the rest of it this is analytic, okay. That is an analytic function and you cannot extend it to you cannot extend this analytic function to any point on the negative real axis, okay. Simply because at any point in the negative real axis the argument function is discontinuous, and the argument function is the imaginary part of your log function, okay. So you can't do anything. So you take this analytic function. Now the amazing thing is, you know, you take a path that does not cross the origin, even if it crosses this negative real axis, you can still analytically continue it, okay. So even though this whole negative real axis is full of bad points, its points, they are all non-isolated singularities, you see, they are all, this is a whole continuous ray, it is a continuous line, they are full of singularities for the function, okay. In spite of that, you know, if you draw an arc which crosses the negative real axis, you, and then you can really analytically continue log, and you know what it will be, you are going to continue log to the next branch, which is actually a continuation which is happening on the Riemann surface of log Z, which is being reflected here, okay. So log Z can be analytically continued on any path in C minus 0. It is amazing, even if that, so even if that path crosses the negative real axis, even if the path crosses the negative real axis, you can analytically continue it, okay. So you are able to, so here is an example of an analytic function which can be analytically continued across a point along a path which passes through a very bad point, and here is one that cannot be continued along a path which passes through a bad point. So you see, so you know, analytic continuation is one more tool of trying to distinguish between analytic functions in terms of properties, okay. So I will try to explain this in more detail later, but I will like you to check that this is the case, okay. So in particular, I would like you to try it as an exercise. You take a path which goes like this, you start with log Z here, okay, start with log Z here, and at this point you take log Z, so let me write it, so here I will take log Z plus 2 pi I, okay, and this log Z plus 2 pi I is certainly analytic continuation of log Z along that path, you can make it, okay. So I want you to try that as an exercise, show that along this path which crosses the negative real axis, log Z can be analytically continued to log Z plus 2 pi I. So you know, the beautiful thing is, even though you are crossing this this ray, there is another avatar of there is another branch of the log function which continues it, which lives, okay, across that that negative real axis is full of bad points. So I wanted to prove this as an exercise. So okay, so show that if you take a arc like this going from the upper half plane to the lower half plane crossing the negative real axis, you start with log z above and you end up with log z plus 2 pi I, two different successive branches of the logarithm. Show that you can actually, you can find an analytic continuation that goes from here to here. So our aim is, you know, you have a function which is analytically continuable and you want to know what is the final function that you get at the end of the analytic continuation, okay, that is the aim. So the monodromy, there is something called the monodromy theorem which says when the final analytic continuation is going to be the same even if you change the path, okay. So there are many versions of the so-called monodromy theorem. So I'll give you one. I'll give you the first version of the monodromy theorem. So here is the monodromy theorem. So the idea is like this. You see, I start with a point z naught. I start with a point z naught, and I end with a point z one. Okay, and I have a path. Gamma, okay, and along the path gamma I have an analytic continuation given by a power series ft of z sigma n equal to 0 to infinity a n t z minus gamma t to the power of n for mod z minus r of t lesser than z minus gamma t less than rt. So this is one analytic continuation of fa to fb, okay, where a is this is just z naught is gamma a and z1 is gamma b. You know that fb is completely determined by fa, okay, we have seen that for this particular path. Now suppose, so as far as I fixed, see if this path is fixed, its parameterization is fixed and the starting function is fixed, then I know that every analytic continuation I am going to get later on, each of those functions is fixed, that we have already proved, that was this theorem, okay. The question is, how will the ending function change if you change the path? So you know, instead of gamma, suppose I give you another path eta. So eta is another path which also starts at z naught and ends at z1, okay, and suppose you have another analytic continuation along eta, okay, such that eta t of z is given by something sigma n equal to 0 to infinity some b n t z minus eta t to the power of n mod z minus eta t is less than r. So here maybe for clarity I will put r of gamma of t and here I will put r of eta of t. So suppose I have another analytic continuation, okay, and assume that eta a is the same as fa, okay, with the initial functions are the same, fa is the same as I should have used not eta, eta is the path, I should have used g, so let me use g. So fa is ga, okay. So I am having on this all the fts which starts with fa here and ends with fb here, and along this path I have gts which starts with GA which is the same as FA, and I am going to get a GB. What is the relationship between FB and GB? So the question is, the monodromy theorem, one version of the monodromy theorem says when you can guarantee that FB and GB are the same, and the answer is, it is a topological answer, it is when gamma can be continuously deformed to neta, okay. If you can continuously deform gamma to neta, then FB and GB will be the same. In other words, if you start with a given analytic function and you analytically continue it along a path, that analytic continuation you get at the end of the path is going to be independent of the path so long as the path, the paths are the same up to a deformation of one another, which is what in topology is called as a homotopy. Okay, so that's monotomy theorem version 1. There are other versions which also I will explain. So given analytic continuations, this and this with FA is equal to GA, if the path gamma can be continuously deformed or is homotopic to neta, then FB is equal to GB. So if you start with a function and so long as you deform it along so long as you analytically continue it along a path, the final function that you get is not going to be is not going to change if your path is going to change only up to a continuous deformation, namely up to a homotopy. Okay, so so this is this has a very nice statement in terms of covering space theory also. It can be rephrased as the action of the fundamental group on the germs of analytic functions on the covering space. Okay, so it can be rephrased. I'll try to explain that also in a later lecture. So the point I want to make is that if you have a path gamma and if you have another path eta which are homotopic, this is called fixed endpoint homotopy, which means that, you know, you can find paths like this continuously, you can find a continuous sequence of paths, a continuous family of paths which start with gamma and end with eta, like this. So I deform this path gamma to the path neta. If I can do that, then the analytic continuation along neta and the analytic continuation along gamma and the analytic continuation on neta along neta will be the same. In fact, it will be the same for every, you take anything in between which is a deformation, for all the cases the final along any of these paths, you know, the function you get there upon analytic continuation, it will be the same. It will be the same as this FB. You will get only one. Okay, so that is the content of the monotomy theorem. Okay, so I'll explain the proof of that in the next lecture.